Amen. That's not what I'm supposed to be preaching, but I felt that. Amen. You got to stand on the rock. Man, let's go back to that verse. Let's go back to that scripture in 1 Kings chapter 19. And it says, so Elijah left him and went back home, took his yoke of oxen, slaughtered them, burned the plowing equipment. My God, he burned the plowing equipment to cook the meat and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he set out to follow Elijah and became his attendant, or became his servant. I want to minister from the subject for just a few moments, from the idea glad to serve, or you could say serve with gladness. However you want to write that, put that in the chat, put that in the text. Amen. Serve with gladness, or glad to serve. Amen. I like glad to serve best myself. But however you want to phrase that, that's going to be our theme. That's going to be our subject for today. Let's ask God for the help that we need in this moment. Lord, Holy Spirit, we thank you, Lord, for the saving Son that is in our hearts right now, that we now have the Savior in our lives. We thank you that we're now filled with your Spirit. We thank you, Lord, that now we know who you are. And, Lord, we come this morning seeking a word from you. We come this morning to sit at your table, to feast on your word. So now, Lord, we need you, Lord, to prepare the word for us. Lord, make preaching and teaching easy. Speak, Holy Spirit. Speak the words to us that will give us life. Speak the words to us that will give us a little bit more running in our step. Speak, Holy Spirit. And once again, Lord, give us an anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. We thank you, God. Move me out of the way. Forgive me for my sins. Cleanse me of all unrighteousness and make me ready to be used by you. Speak now, Holy Spirit, and we'll forever give your name the praise. And all the people of God said, amen. Praise God. Praise God. Glad to serve, or serve with gladness. Praise God. Serving God, beloved, is not always simple and easy. No. I wish it was. I wish serving God was always simple, was always easy. But sometimes serving God can be challenging. Serving God can have some complexity to it. Serving God sometimes is tough. It's not always stressless. I know a lot of us thought that when we came to the Lord, it was going to be stressless work, and that it was going to be stress-free work, that serving God wasn't going to cause you any concern, that serving God it was going to be work that could be done quick and fast and in a hurry. But can I let you know something? Serving God is not always work that can be done quickly or overnight. Serving God requires patience. Serving God requires tenacity. Serving God requires some stick-to-itness, because there are going to be things along the way that are going to get in your way and want to discourage you from serving the Lord. Oh, yeah, I've been serving God. I've been running with God. Amen. I was ordained a deacon in 1989, 31-plus years ago. Amen. So I've been running with the Lord as a deacon, as a minister, as an associate pastor, as pastor for a long time. And I can tell you right now, in that 31 years of serving the Lord, that there have been some times where I realized, oh, this serving God thing is not easy. It's tricky sometimes. Yeah, you got to work with some tricky folk. You got to work sometimes with some difficult people. You got to work with some folk that will stress you out. Serving God is not always. And then on top of that, the enemy is going to try to get in your way. The enemy is going to put all sorts of obstacles. Amen. The enemy is going to put all sorts of roadblocks in your way. The enemy is going to put all sorts of things in your path to discourage you. Amen. And then sometimes you're going to be the roadblock yourself. Sometimes you're going to do things that are going to cause you to be stressed out trying to do the work of the Lord. But nevertheless, amen, whether it's from somebody else, from inside you, or from the devil himself, or any of the number of minions that he has at his disposal, there's going to always be something that's going to try to discourage you from serving God. That's how you know it's good work. Amen. Because anything that's worse something, anything that's good work, the enemy's going to try to get in there. Amen. Nothing really good, nothing really worthwhile is always simple, easy, and uncomplicated. Well, praise God. Praise God. I'm here to encourage you today. Amen. You ought to serve with gladness. Amen. Because, see, I have to let you, gladness is understanding. It's an attitude. Amen. I'm thankful. I'm grateful and I'm excited. Everybody say that. Hey, when we talk about being glad, I'm thankful, I'm grateful, and I'm excited. That's how you ought to serve God, thankful, grateful, and excited. Amen. And every now and then, the servants of the Most High, I know I've been one myself, amen, you get weary in well-doing. You get tired in trying to serve the Lord. I don't know about you. Maybe you don't ever get tired of serving God. Maybe you are all, you got it all together. You dot all I's and cross all the T's and you're the perfect spiritual specimen. But me, let me talk about me. Every now and then I get tired. I get weary. Not because it's a lot. Not because I didn't get enough sleep or not because I didn't get enough eat. Not because I didn't have enough rest. But it's just sometimes there's obstacles in your way. There's trouble in your way. There's difficulty in your way. There's stuff in your way that wears you down. But I got good news today. You ought to serve God with gladness. I've got good news that God wants glad servants. Amen. He don't want sad servants. He don't want angry servants. He don't want upset servants. He wants glad servants, grateful, excited, and glad, amen, to be in the service of the Lord. I didn't want to get to this point yet, but I'll get to it. The first point of being glad to serve, you ought to be grateful and excited and thankful to serve the Lord, because the Lord didn't have to put you in his service. Amen. The Lord did not have to put you in a position where you're going to get a crown of righteousness. The Lord did not have to put you in a position, amen, where you get a reward in heaven. The Lord did not have to position you to get blessed for serving him right now. The Lord didn't have to position you to do it, but God did, because of his grace and his mercy. And we ought to be glad to serve. Amen. We ought to be grateful, excited, and thankful to serve. You ought to be thankful. And you know what? I found out every now and then when you get tired, when you're not as grateful as you should be and not as thankful as you should be and not as excited to serve God, God will put somebody around you that's more grateful, more thankful, and more excited to remind you of the work that you serve and the attitude you ought to have and the privilege it is to serve God. Every now and then, God will bring somebody who's fresh in the Lord. He'll bring somebody around you who's so thankful and so grateful. It'll remind you that you ought to be grateful and thankful and excited just like that. Every now and then, God will send somebody who just found Christ for themselves and just thankful that God saved their soul. He'll put them around somebody who's been running with God for a while and remind that person who's been serving God for a while of the kind of excitement and the kind of freshness that you ought to have because God has chosen you to serve. Every now and then, God will put somebody with some excitement, with some joy, with a big smile on their face right next to you. You've been serving God for 30 years. You've been serving God for 20 years. You've seen God do miracle after miracle, blessing after blessing. He's giving you opportunity after opportunity, and you're sitting there like somebody just gave you a lemon to suck on, and God sends somebody that just got baptized the week before and they served God 5 minutes, ain't seen a miracle yet. Only miracle they know is that God took their soul out of darkness into the marvelous light, and they just glad to serve the Lord. They just glad to stand out and hand out a bulletin. They just glad to be in the parking lot and letting folk know we have a service on the inside. They just glad to sometimes to kind of shame us a little bit and to remind us and awaken in us a passion that we should have had for the Lord. Oh, that's what we see in the text here. There's somebody that's been running with God for a minute. Amen. We have seen the last 3.5 years of this man's ministry. Elijah had been running with God for a minute, seeing miracle on top of miracle, blessing on top of blessing, supernatural occurrence on top of supernatural occurrence. One could only dream of seeing some of the things that Elijah has seen God do. But Elijah got weary in the well-doing. Elijah got stressed in the serving. Elijah got tired in doing the work for the Lord, and he got a little upset. You know the story. Jezebel got mad. Jezebel said, I'm going to kill you, Elijah, because I've been killing everybody else who's serving God. I'm going to get you. And Elijah ran for his life. He had a breakdown, but God blessed him. God kept him. God renewed him. God restored him. And then God began to tell Elijah, okay, Elijah, I need you to go back the way you came. Amen. I already got this thing figured out. I know you got worried. I know you're about to lose your mind, but don't worry. I have this under control. I've got this, Elijah. No need for you to fear Jezebel. I've got a dude for her and a guy. I got two brothers that are going to do, you're going to anoint them a king, and then I got another brother that's going to come in, and he's going to help you with the prophetic ministry. Don't worry, amen. I've got this under control. I preached that last week when I said God has it's already fixed. It's already taken care of. It's already done. God's already figured it out. Praise God. Remember when I said it last week? God has already figured it out. Let me just say that again, because maybe somebody wasn't here last week. Maybe you skipped out on service. Let me help you here. God's already figured out how to take care of your situation. It doesn't catch God off guard. God is not surprised by any trouble or difficulty that you go through. That's why you shouldn't lose your mind in any situation, because God has already figured it out. You may not know how he's figured it out. You may not have understood it. It may be bigger than what you understand, but guess what? God, like I said last week, he has options you never even imagined. You and I have limited options. That's why we cannot see the end from the beginning, because we can't see it all, but our God has unlimited options at his disposal and can do anything and stuff you couldn't even imagine. That's why God is not overwhelmed with your situation, because God said, I already got it. I got it figured out. I got it fixed. And God told Elijah, you're worried about Jezebel, but I've already got it already figured out. I have it already figured out for you, Elijah. He says, Elijah, I'm going to go back the way you came. And one of your responsibilities, Elijah, is to go find Elisha and put a mantle on him. That was a prophetic coat, like a cloak, and put it on him, and let him know he was going to now move into this prophetic ministry. We don't know a lot about Elisha. We don't know too much about him, but we do know that God tells Elijah, go to him and anoint him. Amen. I got work for him to do. And so now Elijah with the J we've been a little frustrated. Elijah with the J has been a little stressed out. Elijah with the J had some trouble with God, and then God is trying to help him get to where he needs to be. And what is God going to do? God's going to put him near somebody that's going to remind him of how he ought to be. He's going to put him around somebody that's going to remind him of what you should look like when you serve the Lord. Amen. Elisha with the S, amen, is going to help us today serve with gladness, or be glad to serve. So the Bible says, Elijah with the J goes back. Look here in verse 19. So Elijah went from there, because he was in the cave. He was crying. He was upset with God. But God now sends him back and found Elisha with the S, the son of Shaphat. He was plowing with 12 oxen, 12 yoke of oxen. That's 12 pair of oxen. And he himself was driving the 12th pair. Amen. Let's go right into this. Let's break this down. Let me give you some background here. Elijah finds Elisha. He is in a row with 12 other people leading 24 oxen in groups of twos. And Elisha, is at the end with the last pair. He is with ox 23 and ox 24, and he has got them. He's got them yoked together as a pair, and he's behind them with the plow. He is 12th in line, plowing up the soil. I need you to kind of get an understanding of this. Amen. Israel did not use too many horses. They used oxen. oxen to do the plowing. An oxen was the equivalent of your really expensive John Deere or Kubota farm tractor. We're talking about the top of the line kind of stuff here that this brother has. And he's got two of them connected, amen, to 22 others. It's a lot of money in this field. It's a lot of resources in this field. Now, let's break this down. They are plowing a field in the fourth year, 3.5 months, amen. So they went 3 years, and now they're going into the fourth year, halfway through the fourth year of what was a drought. Recently, it had rained, praise God. So the ground had been without rain, amen, for 3.5 years, and now it has begun to rain. We know that from the previous chapters, and they have seen it all fit now to go till and plow the soil. But can I help you? After 3.5 years of no rain, the soil is extremely hard. Even with fresh rain, the soil is really tough. It is so tough, amen, that you got 24 oxen trying to till up this hard soil. God is trying to speak to Elijah and teach Elijah some stuff. Anytime you had a drought for a long period of time, the ground is hard. This is a metaphor. There have been a drought in Israel, not just of rain, but a drought of people leading the people of God to serve God. The folk had not been serving God that much. Only a remnant had been serving God. The majority of the nation had been a drought. They had kind of been without the word of God. They had kind of not had a lot of preaching going on. They had kind of had not good leadership going on. So the ground of their hearts was difficult. And anytime you got some difficult ground, you need to do a whole lot of plowing before you can do any planting. You're not hearing what I'm saying. God is going to help Elijah see something, that it has to be a whole lot of plowing before there's some planting. Because Elijah's issue was, God, it seems too hard. God, it seems too tough. God, it seems too difficult. What God is showing Elijah in a very simple picture here, that Elijah, I'm trying to help you with bless the people. You need to understand that the people are hard right now, and your responsibility is to go ahead and do some plowing. You got to do some plowing first before you can do any planting. Amen. You're trying to get fruit. Well, Elijah, you're too far in the process. Hey, these people aren't ready to produce any fruit. We're just trying to plow the soil right now. We're just trying to get them ready for the deep things of God. You want to get full commitments out of these folks. You want to get have them to go from being hard-hearted, serving Baal, serving Asherah, with the king leading them in the wrong direction, with injustice running the street. You want to take them there to automatically overnight being sold out saints of God? Nah, beloved, their hearts aren't ready. There's got some plowing that needs to be done before there's some planting that's going to happen. And Elijah, I'm going to take you to somebody who is plowing 12th in line. And 12th in line meant the ground is really hard. Normally, you just need one or two oxen. They've got 24 working, and he's 12 in line. You know how hard that ground had to be. If you're last in line in a group of 12 trying to till the soil, you've got 24 equivalent of big John Deere tractors trying to grow the same hole, and you need 24 of them to tear this thing up. That's hard. And God is trying to show Elijah something. Amen. Just because the work is hard don't mean you shouldn't be glad. Hallelujah. Amen. Just because the work is difficult don't mean you oughtn't come to work with a smile on your face. Just because the work is big doesn't mean that with help you can't get it done. My God. God is showing Elijah here that a man cannot till the soil by himself, but if he's got help, amen, they can do it together. And so those who are glad to serve, let me give you the points here. Number one, are grateful, thankful, and excited. Amen. Even though the work is big. Oh, y'all, somebody ought to get God some praise and shout. In spite of how big the work is, they're grateful, excited, and thankful to be able to do it. They're grateful to be able to. Look, Elijah is 12th in line. This is his daddy's field. These are probably his daddy's oxen. That's what most scholars think. Amen. And he's 12th in line. He's in the back. Amen. I don't care about, nobody wants to be in the back, but he's in the back. Amen. But he's glad, he's excited, and he's grateful to serve. And that's how we ought to be, whether we're in the front of the line or the back of the line. Are we grateful to serve? See, some of y'all would always have to want to be in the front. Amen. You'd always want to be out there in the front. And if you ain't in the front, you ain't happy. Or if you ain't being seen, you're not happy. Here is this brother in the back of the line, amen, just plowing with a smile on his face. Now, understand, when you're in the back of the line, the ground is uneven. It's really uneven because it's been tilled by 11 other sets of oxen in front of you. The ground is breaking up, so it's not smooth. The person in the front, it ain't as bad, but the person at the back, you got the rocks being tossed to the side, you got the ground is uneven, you got a trench you're trying to walk through, and you got 22 other oxen dropping poop in front of you, and you got to navigate around the poop mess and still keep a straight line. Oh, this is the kind of brother that God can use. This is the kind of, you know, amen, he's glad and excited. He's in the back, amen. He is plowing, amen. He's not complaining. He's doing his job. He's working around the obstacles. He's working around the poop. He's working around the mess, amen. And can I help you? Sometimes in ministry, sometimes in serving the Lord, you're going to have to walk in the back. Sometimes you're going to have to walk around people's mess. Sometimes you're going to have to walk around obstacles. But you got to do it, amen, grateful, excited, and thankful that you're in his service. Praise God. This is the kind of person that God can use. He's walking around poop. He's walking around rocks. He's walking around uneven ground, but he's still keeping a straight line. Oh, this is the kind of person that we'd like to have, because some of us had to do that. We would be mad. We'd be busted and disgusted. We would say, hold on, my daddy owned all this. I shouldn't have to do this. I shouldn't have to do all this kind of stuff. Amen. I'm too important to do that. But you should never be too important, amen, to serve with gladness and be the person in the back. Oh, that's Elijah here. That's Elisha here. And Elijah is, God sends him to the person that's in the back. He didn't send him to the worst and it was leading. He said, I want you to get the person in the back, because the person in the back is going to be grateful. The person in the back is going to be thankful. Amen. The person in the back is going to look at this as a promotion. The person in the back is going to look at this as an opportunity. The person in the back is going to see this as a great privilege. He's going to be thankful and grateful for the come up. This person is going to be thankful. You over here seeing miracle after miracle, Elijah, and you not grateful at all. But I guarantee you, let that brother know, amen, he's going to be the one. You put a cloak on him, he's going to get to running. He's going to lose his mind. He's going to be grateful, excited, and thankful to have an opportunity to do it. You over here telling God, I'm the only one. You over here telling God, I don't want to do it, Elijah. But there's another Elisha. There's another person, amen, that'll take your same job. Take your same job and run with that thing and be glad to do it. This is Elijah. And so Elijah comes to him and he catches him with 12 oxen. And you need to see this. Amen. It's been a drought for 3.5 years. The ground is hard. He's behind 22 oxen. He's got the 23rd and the 24th. And he's plowing behind and navigating through poop and mess and rocks and all sorts of stuff. It's stinky where he's at. But he's still holding the plow. Oh, God, my God. This is how we got to be, y'all. This is how we got to be. We got to be. Can we be in the back of the line, dealing with all the stink, the mess, the obstacle, and still be serving with gladness? Hallelujah. This is the kind of person God looking for. This is the kind of person God shows Elijah. He said, this is the kind of person, I'm going to show you how excited you ought to be. Because Elisha is plowing a hard ground. The same way, Elijah, I'm calling you to plow and do this work. This work is tough. It's just like plowing hard soil. And beloved, serving God sometimes is just like plowing hard soil. It's not easy. It's not easy. It's not easy. But you got to be glad, excited, grateful, amen, to be in the service. Amen. You got to be able to, amen, navigate through the obstacles and the stink, amen, because it's difficult. It's difficult, praise God. But can you do it with a smile? Can you do it with some joy? Can you do it with some excitement? And let me help you here. You can do, and those who are glad to serve, understand this. Those who are glad to serve aren't only just grateful, excited, and thankful. Amen. People who are glad to serve understand they can't do this work by themselves. See, Elijah, the previous guy, he was trying to do it by himself. And now he runs up on a guy who's in a group of 12. That's an important number. He's in a group of 12, and he's the 12th guy. Amen. And they're doing it together, one after the other, together, not in competition. You can't plow good if y'all trying to outplow each other. You got to stay behind the other person. That means you got to know how to follow. That means you got to be looking straight ahead and looking at the person in front of you and walking on them. Amen. And that means Silla, and that means somebody is building off you and you building off somebody else. Amen. We ain't nobody doing this thing together. The first person couldn't do it, and the last person couldn't do it without the first person. It's teamwork. Everybody say teamwork. Amen. You're glad to serve when you understand you need a team. You can't do it by yourself. You need a team. I don't care how gifted you are. I don't care how strong you are. You need a team. Amen. And can I help you? You not only do you need a team, the team needs you. You need a team and the team needs you. Amen. That's why I have to always stress why the enemy would love to take us and get us out of line with each other. And get us fighting each other, because the enemy know the work is big and we need a team and we got to do this thing together. The enemy would love to get us fighting with each other, because that would mean that we're not able to get the work done. The groove that we're trying to cut requires all of us to walk in step with each other. Oh, God is trying to show Elijah something. Elijah, you can't cut this ground by yourself. And when I'm talking about ground, he's saying the work that God has for you, the work that God has for you to save Israel, to take Israel out of this, cannot be done with one lone star dude. You need a team, brother. So I'm going to take you to somebody who's got experience working with other folk and ain't got no problem being in the back. Ooh, wow. See, God can use folk that don't have to be in the front. They know that they know it's not about the person, it's about the team. It's about a team. It's about a team. It's about a team. It's about a team. And y'all got to understand that second part. It's about the team. It's not about the Pastor Hodge. It's not about a board. It's about a team. It's about a team. I was sharing at the church meeting. There was some stuff I want to do, but the team said, let's wait a little bit. And you know what? We a team. I need the team. And I hope the team needs me. Amen. I hope y'all need, but I know I need y'all. And the team got to do everything in step. And if we ain't in step, you can't do the choir right if y'all, the team ain't working right. You can't do the musicians if the team ain't working right. Amen. It's got to be a beautiful composition that come, where we come all together. It's got to be team, y'all. And you got to be glad to be part of a team. Oh, my gosh. Those who are glad to serve most of the time realize that they need the team. They need the team. And so, because Elijah with the J, his issue was he was trying to do that thing solo. And God said, bro, you need a team. You need a team. And this is the first part of your team right here, this brother, amen, who understands teamwork. Whoo, look at him. You know, because you could have thought maybe Elijah, God was going to send Elijah to pick the guy that was leading the 12. He gets a person that's in the back of the line, the 12th guy. That's how God does it sometimes. God don't always pick the first. A lot of times God picked the person at the end. Amen. Because the person at the end is normally more humble than the person in the front. Whew. Amen. And I have to constantly remind myself that as a pastor, you better stay humble, boy. You better stay humble. Understand, you got to stay humble. Stay humble. Stay humble. Amen. Because there's a trick and a trap that pastors get into. Start thinking you ahead of the team. No. I got to remind myself I'm just part of the team. Sometimes I might be in the front. Sometimes I might be in the back. But I'm not. I'm just part of the team. We part of the team, y'all. We a team. We got to work this thing together. And when you do it and when you realize that it's about the team, You can't put it all on your shoulders. We need each other. Amen. You're more thankful and grateful, and you don't wear yourself out. You know, a lot of times when you're not glad because you're mad and you're tired, you're doing too much. But when you're working as a team, amen, the burden is distributed evenly. Ooh-wee. That's how you know you got a good team. When the burden, 24 oxen hooked together, 12 plows all in line, they carrying the load, distributing the weight and the burden evenly. Amen. Everybody got different jobs, but we all equally important to the mission. Teamwork, teamwork, teamwork. I got to get a couple of these out. Let's see. I said, okay, number three, they don't mind following. We talked about that, right? I said, you don't, people who are glad to serve don't have to lead all the time. Make sure that's the number three. Amen. Make sure that's number three. So this is who Elijah finds. He puts his cloak on him, and that boy gets to running. Elijah walks by him, drops his cloak on him, puts it on him, and keeps walking. Elijah, you know, you got to think about this thing for a second. He knew who Elijah was, because everybody knew who Elijah was. And he understood what the mantle meant. Some trying to say mantle. If they knew what that cloak meant, it meant you were now part of the prophets. Now, we don't know if Elijah had shown some prophetic abilities prior to this. We don't know. We're not really privy to that. But he understood when Elijah put his cloak on him, the weight of what just happened. He understood it. And he ran after Elijah and told him, let me just go back and tell my mom and daddy goodbye, and I'm with you. And then there's a phrase in there that said, what have I done to you? That's a phrase that's difficult. They would have difficulty ever interpreting. They think it just means do whatever you have to do. That's what they think it means. That's what they think it means. It's because it says, what have I done to you? It doesn't make any sense. Most people, scholars, they're not sure. They think it just says, do what you have to do. And Elisha was quick with it. He runs back, kisses his mom. Mom and dad, he kills the oxen that he has, makes a sacrifice of them, lets everyone eat them. He takes the equipment that he had, breaks up the wood, chops it up, and makes it a fire and cooks the oxen right there, feeds everybody that was working, and then he's out and he follows Elijah on the rest of his journey. But I like that because it did a couple things. First of all, people who are glad to serve respect protocols and rules. He said, hold on, what we mean protocol and rules? Elisha knew he couldn't just leave his dad's stuff unattended. And he knew he couldn't leave without respectfully telling his mom and father goodbye. He had to do that. And he had some expensive equipment that he was in charge of, that he was a steward over, that he had to get his father's permission to do anything with that. Elisha does not have the legal right to kill these oxen and destroy this plow. This protocol has to happen. He can't walk away from this responsibility he has with his father. If he was just out all willy-nilly, he could have just left. But he's got a responsibility, and I like that because, see, people who are glad to serve understand that sometimes you got to respect protocols and rules in place, amen, because that's just respectful. It's just being respectful. Let me tell you something I see sometimes in the church. Folks sometimes will just run over stuff and be disrespectful. Now, I always had to give a caveat. Sometimes traditions need to change. Sometimes rules need to change. Protocols are not always necessary. But when you're glad to serve, you don't let those things hinder you from doing what you got to do. You just do it. Someone said, well, why I got to do it? Is it a big deal to ask you to do that? See, Is it a big deal to fill out a form? Is it a big deal to put it in the way they asked you to put it in? I mean, would it take you 5 minutes? Is it really a big deal to respect protocols and rules and not assume it's not all about you? And sometimes you got to respect other folk in your way. He was about to leave these, supposedly probably men, to do the field one short. So he wasn't going to leave them without blessing them. But in order to bless them, he had to get his dad's permission and make sure he left respectfully. He had to respect some things, which weren't hard to do, stuff he could do quick and easy. He did not have to go spend and wait. You know, when that situation comes with Jesus in that parable, that person was talking about spending a long time trying to get something done that was unnecessary. This was something necessary for this young man to do, to respect protocol and rules. My God, is it that hard to do? Because see, what we do sometimes in church is that, well, I got to do what I got to do. No, respect them. Just take a second. Do what you got to do. And what is it going to do? Is it that big of a deal? I'm always quick, fast, and in a hurry. But every now and then, I got to slow myself down to respect some rules and protocols. Because some people put that stuff in place and thought a lot about it. And I'm just going to overshot and go around them and act like they don't matter. And God pulled me back and say, be respectful. Protocol. Do what you got to do. And be glad about it. And be glad about it. Those who are glad to serve realize that others are important. And respecting others is important. And sometimes respecting protocols that others put in place is important. This is what Elijah does. This is the kind of guy, this is the kind of person that God, oh, I can use him, I can use him, I can use him, I can use him. And say, Elijah, I'm going to show you. He's going through a couple of hoops to take care of business. This is the kind of guy you can use because he's got an attention to detail. And it's not throwing him off that he's got to run back for a few minutes, handle some stuff, be respectful, take care of the guys. He's going to leave a man short. Two oxen short and one plow short to do this work that you got to do that's based on a time schedule. Now they got to do it with less resources. He's respectful to them, considerate of them, makes them a good meal. He had to get his daddy's permission. He couldn't just do that though. He said, I'm going to take care of you. You're going to remember, you're going to have good memories of me. Respect protocol. Respect protocol. Okay, y'all. Some of y'all weren't prepared for that this morning, but I'm going to give it to you. Amen. Amen. Also, I like this part. Those who are glad to serve have a sense of urgency. We already talked about that. And excitement. He runs both ways, I think. He's like this and like that. He's got a sense of urgency. Praise God. Praise God. What you waiting on God for? What your sense of urgency? God was quick to save your soul. God was quick to deliver you. God was quick to answer your prayer that time. Sometimes he didn't answer prayer your fair, but you got some prayers that God answered quick. Don't act like you don't. Don't act like you ain't got some prayers that God opened that thing while you was praying. I know he didn't answer all your prayers fast all the time, but there have been some times where God showed up that day in your situation. There have been some time you got the money the same day you got the bill. There have been some time the healing showed up the same day the doctor told you you were sick. There have been some time that while they was working on you, God did a miracle. There have been some time while you were almost about to lose your mind, and before you had a chance to think of it twice, God stepped in. Don't act like there ain't been some time where God did not show up quick, fast, and as the choir say, suddenly in your life. Don't you act like that. Don't you act like that. Don't you act like God ain't done some stuff fast for you. Ah, Elijah, because he's excited about what God can do. He's excited about this opportunity. Listen here, check this out. Elijah with the J, God got to drag from place to place. And now here's Elijah running. What you want me to do? What you want me to do? I'm ready. I'm ready. He's got a sense of urgency. Praise God, praise God. Now let me get the last one. And those who glad to serve are willing to make sacrifices. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. kill the oxen, kill the plow. He ain't trying. Now the sacrifice is this. He's saying, I'm not going back to this. There's some stuff that God calls us and say, you can't go back to that and serve me. And guess what? It wasn't a bad thing. Oftentimes we say God has to cut, God needs to cut the bad stuff out of my life. Sometimes God is cutting the thing that's just not right for you in this season. And are you willing to cut it? It's not a, plowing a field in a team of 12 for your dad and serving your family. Ain't nothing wrong with that. But every now and then, God will say, I need you to go forward, and there's some good things. I need you to go ahead and say, well, that's not my role right now. Working on dad's farm is not my mission that God has for me right now. That's what Elijah's saying. And his dad was cool with it because his dad saw the vision. His dad saw, okay, I see. That's the man of God? That's the man of God you with? Okay, I ain't mad at you. You go serve the man of God. You know, because his father was a believer, amen. But remember, Elijah didn't think there was any. He said, I'm the only one that's serving you. No, you got a guy named Shaphat over here. They got a big team of oxen, amen, a rich guy. And somehow God has supernaturally kept his oxen well-fed and during a 3.5-year drought. You got somebody that's been receiving the favor of God. Look, Elijah, you thought you're the only one that has miracles in your life. I got Shaphat over here. Look at him. He's plowing with 12 oxen, 24 oxen. How in the world did them 24 oxen stay fed? King Ahab couldn't even find food for his animals, but I got a brother here over here, and all his animals well fed, and they got enough strength to plow out this field. You think you the only one that's been getting God's favor? I've been giving him favor, so much so that when you want to take his son and take him out the field to go follow you, he is ready to do it. Man, because Elisha ain't the only person showing some faith in this situation. His daddy let him go. His daddy let him sacrifice his animals. His daddy let him sacrifice his good plow to go serve God. Guess what? His daddy is saying that. I understand how to serve God too. I know how to sacrifice too. I believe Elijah didn't just become a glad servant. I think his daddy is showing somebody who is quick to sacrifice. His daddy, that's why they mentioned the father, because somebody would have said, well, how did Elijah couldn't have sacrificed those sheep? How did he did it? They said, you know, some of y'all know him. He was a man of God himself. He was somebody who didn't serve Baal, didn't serve Asherah. He was a person that didn't believe in what Ahab was doing. He was a beloved of God as well. He had been getting favor. Yeah, we know Shaphat. He was a man that had 24 oxen that still was well fed during this time of drought. He was a man that God had favored his household. When other folk were losing stuff, he's gaining stuff in a drought. He had favor in a famine. Elijah, I'm taking you to somebody that I've been blessing too. You ain't the only person that's been receiving miracles. You ain't the only person that's seen miracles. I had this daddy has been seeing miracles, and he's so willing. He's seen God do so much. He's willing to let his son walk away with you with blessings. Shaphat already knew how. Shaphat, go ahead, son. You can sacrifice the animals. You can feed them. Because people didn't eat meat like we eat meat. They didn't have all that. This was a big deal. This was a big deal. You don't get rid of your tractor during plowing season. You don't let no servants go, and you don't let your son go during plowing season. But Shaphat said, we're gonna make this sacrifice unto the Lord. Because he's glad. You make that kind of sacrifice at joyous occasions. My God. Y'all thought the story was just about Elisha. You got to understand the rules and protocols here. He went back and talked to his daddy. And the daddy, we're going to send you off with a blessing. Because Elisha did not have that ability to make that call. He needed his daddy's permission. That's why they mentioned his daddy in the story. Because somebody said, well, did he get permission to do that? And people knew who Shaphat was. Hallelujah. See, those who are glad to serve don't have no problem making a sacrifice. They don't have no problem letting go of some stuff and offering some stuff up to the Lord for the Lord to use. They're glad to do it. Now he did not sacrifice all his oxen. He didn't sacrifice 12 plows. He sacrificed less than 10%. 8% be exact, 8-something%. He said, that's all, we're going to do that, and we're going to celebrate you. That's the sacrifice. Praise God. He's willing to sacrifice. This is who God looks for, those who will sacrifice, don't have no problem following, don't have to lead, amen, who are glad, grateful, excited, and thankful to work unto the Lord, amen, who understand that it's about teamwork. That's how, when we coming back, amen, God set this COVID thing for many reasons. He allowed it. And I know one thing for the church, he wants us coming back, not like Elijah, but like Elisha, with gladness, excited to serve. Now, praise God, that's the sermon for today. Amen. I hope something spoke to your heart and some God spoke to you some way. That's my prayer. If you don't know the Lord, God is ready to save your soul. God is ready to put you into his service, to use you for his glory. God wants to use you, but he wants to save you first. He wants to change your heart. God wants to get your heart ready so he can plant into you the Spirit of the living God. Are you ready to accept the Lord? Open your heart to the Lord today. If you're ready to accept God right now, I encourage you to call our number 804-232-5124. God is trying to plant something in your life right now. He's used circumstances, situations to plow your heart so that you are ready to receive his word. If you're here today and you don't know the Lord, if you're under the sound of my voice, ask Christ to come into your life. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life and save my soul. And just like that, God will save your soul. Your next step is to get connected to some believers. You can call us right now, 804-232-5124. Our ministers are on the phone. If you get a busy signal, hang on. If you get the voicemail, Amy, we'll call you back within at least 24 hours. Praise God, we want to call you. Sometimes we get a lot of calls. But we will try to do our best to get you. Amen. If you want to send us an email or a text message, you can. You can go to our website, 2bcsouthside.org, and you can send us an email or you can send us a message on our Facebook page. There's many ways you can get to us. Amen. And if one way doesn't work, try another. Amen. But we want to get to know you. We want to help you grow in faith. If you're ready to join our church, call us, 804-232-5124. I was walking out of church last week on Sunday, and as I was walking out the door, somebody called, amen, we're ready to join church. Praise God. So we're here. Call us, 804-232-5124. You want to get saved? You want to join our church? Just need prayer? Call us right now. Amen. If you have to leave a message, please leave your name, your number, amen, clearly with the message, so that when we call you back, amen, we can pray for you and be ready to minister to you in your needs. Praise God. Now, some of you will see this service later today or in the afternoon. That's all right. Still call us. Now, church is not open every day, so sometimes it may be a little longer than 24 hours if you call during the week, but we will return that call. We send us a message on Facebook and Messenger. That may sometimes is the easiest and fastest way to get us, but we can get you right then. But there's many ways you connect. We want to connect with you because we know God has a blessing for you. God wants to save you, change your life, and turn your life around. Amen. Don't forget, we got all sorts of good stuff happening this week. Bedtime Bible studies on Tuesday, Bible study on Wednesday, prayer on Thursday. Farmer's Market will be open this Saturday. We're going to be celebrating Juneteenth, and Juneteenth is a reminder that freedom has still been delayed for many of us in this country, that we're still fighting for freedom, because Juneteenth was about the delay of folk in Galveston, Texas, slaves, knowing they were emancipated. Almost 2 years, it was delayed. And still freedom, opportunity, is still being delayed. And so when you think about Juneteenth this week, remember, we still don't have all that we are supposed to have. All the freedoms have not been granted to us in reality. Some of them on paper, but we're still fighting, and we still have to fight. Amen. Juneteenth is a reminder that we got to fight because some stuff has still been delayed. But listen, I want you to have a great week. Love you and want heaven to smile and shine upon you. God bless you and go in peace, my brothers and sisters. Have a great day. Love you.